They have an open seat. Okay, those people looking for seats, find the people with the hands in the air. Follow the hands through the seats. You'll make it. Alright, so hold those hands up. The people in the seats. Everybody, like supermarket suites, we're ready. Thank you very much.
'60s and '70s, if I can remember, we used to say 707 is the area code for heaven, or something like that. You know. clearly one of the great philosophic agricultural counties in the world, for which we all give you deep, deep gratitude. There's no accident, therefore, that some of my closest friends live in this area, and I'm pleased to have the chance to be here with two people that for 25 years have been working with me to preserve the archives and to preserve the scholarly records and some of the artifacts of the use of vegetables and plants and drugs to expand human mind throughout history. They run flashbacks books. Where's Michael and Cindy Horowitz? Yeah, all right, yeah. Great, great, great citizens of 707. And with them is Uri Horowitz, Uri Ryder, by the way. Uri, yeah, okay, fine. Their other two daughters, Sunyata and Monona, are not here, but they are in our hearts. Karen and Billy, huh? Okay, stand up. These are wonderful, wonderful friends who have been working to preserve these artifacts and records. They're a real scholar of the history of the brain. I'm also very, very happy to have here tonight someone that we go way, 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 way back together. He is a one of the basic members of the greatest multimedia, hyperdelic, psychedelic, light and sound troupe in world history, the Grateful Dead. There's Ziggy. Ziggy. Yeah. you will learn during the evening, we're going to talk a lot about eyeballs and earballs, and eye drums and eardrums, and I'm going to try to convince you that the original method for operating the brain, going way back 25,000 years, was drumming. The way to bring the society, the group, the tribe together was brain foam, brain talk. In addition to being one of the great drummers of our times, as you know, Mickey has written a book, two books, about the history and art and meaning and philosophy of soul foam, the drum. And he's also, as you I'm sure know, has brought together a wonderful exhibition of global unity, international groups of drummers. So I dedicate tonight's performance to Mickey. I'm very proud to be standing in front of this screen and in sound of these amps because the real show tonight is the work of two groups that I mentioned, Hyper Light Video, Andy and Dave from formerly Tokyo, now 415, and Alora and Genesis PRG. Alora, Genesis PRG, or Psych TV. There you go. There's a special bond of affection between the three of us and the two wonderful young daughters because I know this happened, I'm just not making it up. 1969 or 68, I went to London, got to the airport and tried to go in to see, I think it was either Moody Blues or maybe John Lennon or some disreputable person like that. And 40 little men with stamps and little books came up and said, "You're not allowed in England." I said, "Why not?" Said he. "The Home Office has determined officially that you are a threat to public order and morals." Well, I couldn't deny that. But even today, 25 years later, they still call it the end. And how about a 72-year-old man that's a threat to the British Empire and morals? I mean, all this is to lead up to our little trio here. There are two other people that cannot go into England today because they're a threat to law, order, and morals, Genesis and Alora. As you probably know, they started the house movement, the acid rock music. They did all sorts of incredibly mind-expanding videos, and they were such a success that they're not allowed back in England, so but greater tribute. Yeah. Now, later on, after we do the brain experiments, we'll have we'll call it a question and answer period, because I ain't got no answers, all right? Let that be said, right? We'll have interaction, comment, and argument, I hope. Now the title of tonight's talk is How to Operate Your Brain. And kind of experimental, basically using the old corny thing is the left brain, that's your mind, which is orderly, linear, verbal, you know, and that takes care of the external environment, limited as it is. You know, the Eskimos have like 300 words for snow. But the people living in the Sahara don't have one word for snow. You know that the Italians have 231 words for the female genitalia? Whereas the English language has five. Four of them are not used by Republicans, I mean. What I'm making here is that the left brain, the mind, is very limited both linguistically, and that causes all the trouble. It has been known for thousands of years that there are ways of activating your brain, of communicating, and not in a verbal way. When you're talking brain to brain, you know, no matter what. so we're going to try. The end of it, I'll tell you right in front, is if you want to learn how to operate your brain, you have to go out of your mind to use your head. You have to do it precisely, carefully, and that you can do done by wizards for thousands of years. As a matter of fact, all of our minds have been programmed by some wizards in an hour in the past. We're going to try to demonstrate how this is done with the hope that you will start doing it more and more yourself. Because someone's programmed our brains and very skillfully. And by the way, I want to warn you, there'll be time we're going to try to it's like commercials, you know, scrambled up, you know, like a beer commercial. There are certain points we're going to try to get into your brains. Now, we're warning you ahead of time. There'll be a little label as to what we're going to imprint your brain with, eyeballs, earballs, whatever. So that if you don't want to have your brains imprinted by any part of this, close your eyes over the movie for that. All right. Now, when the lights are on, you'll know that I'm talking to you in the English language, the late 20th century, using minds. And when I say to Laura, as we begin, and to Mary up there, the lights will go out, and the right brain will hopefully be activated in each of your skills. So, Mary, jam the tape, and down with the lights, and Jen, do it.
Oh.
Listen, I'm going to change it. Small groups,
sitting around the cave, fire going, flickering, shadows, faces merging, shadows in the cave wall, crack of the fire, brains beginning to open up, usually with the help of some local vegetable. And then the first technique for operating the brain would come into play. The drum is the original soul poem. All you need were two hands and a log. Or just your own neck cage. The drum brings up the brain. Rhythm. Beat of the heart. The beat of the brain. Beat of the soul.
Treasonous, heretical statement that one would need to make another, because back then, who the fuck do you think you are? Have a self. You're not a self. You're a slave. You're a serf. Who do you think you are? The concept of individuality, subversion. And the idea that you can know it. What is there to know? What is there to know? Well, Socrates wanted to give us a bumper sticker. Socrates gave us some techniques. The first technique was, he didn't lecture what we're doing now. He didn't chip 10 commandments or 10 suggestions. They did a discussion group on a marble tablet. They had a small group and comfortably reclining on couches. And he was to ask questions. What's the meaning of life? What is beauty? How can we improve society? And then you answer. And then you answer. Suddenly you disagree. Suddenly you're performing philosophy. Somebody taught it. The philosophy is not something practiced in ivory towers by bearded professors. It's performing philosophy is a team sport. You have to have someone there. Send it back. That's quantum physics. That's Einstein's relativity. Somebody did another very technical advance. He did use the botanical and vegetable substances bill at the time. There are many stories about how Plato had to be carried home. Now, boys and girls, I'm not advocating boobs, okay? But whatever. I'm simply pointing out the facts, Max, that this happened in Greece. And years later, when I went to a school, graduate school, one went to study after World War II, psychology. Because psychology is the key to know thyself. Wrong, okay? And theory of psychology practice back then was a monopoly of the medical profession. You had to have a psychiatric degree to do that. If you had some performance problem, you know, like a slump, you're down and your interpersonal, offendedness and your depression index goes up, everyone goes to the slump. You go to a medical doctor, he diagnoses your disease and puts you on a couch to cure you. And you think, if anything, we're designed to increase helplessness. I thought about stopping it, and I went to the head of the Palo Alto Veterans Hospital, later famous for having given LSD, having paid Alan Ginsberg and Ken Kesey to take LSD. And I said to the head of the hospital, I wanted to do some research on people coming together to talk about their problems. You can't do that, it's illegal, it's immoral. If patients expose their neuroses, their untidy psychosis to each other, it's contagious. The obsessive compulsive will be all sorts of terrible ideas and paranoid. God knows what the anal patient will do to the oral patient. We did this research. A group just came together and did it. It was a Unitarian church in Berkeley. We called it counseling. That's okay. And I'm proud to say that I was one of the first 10, maybe 10 psychologists in this country to recognize the power of a group. It all came back to Socrates, get that small group together. But what's known as group therapy. I looked in the yellow pages of the LA directory, and there's like a half column of psychiatrists. And there's 7 pages of every fucking kind of group therapy you can think of. If there's not one problem you have or your